Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for standing by, and welcome to the Mediobanca Group 2019-2023 Strategic Guidelines Update. At this time, all participants are in a listen-only mode. After the speaker presentation, there will be a question and answer session. To ask a question during the session, you will need to press star and one on your telephone keypad. I must advise that this conference is being recorded today, Tuesday, the 12th of November, 2019. I would now like to hand the conference over to your presenter today, Mr. Alberto Nagel, CEO. Please go ahead, sir.
Welcome to everybody, and thank you for attending the call. We came to the approval of this new three-year plan after a very strong activity that has reshaped the group strongly and has created a group that has a valuable and distinctive profile in the European financial sector. What we forecast is a further material growth to be delivered in the next 4 years, both in terms of revenues, earnings, capital, profitability, and stakeholder remuneration. Hence, we think that with distinctive and qualitative growth, Mediobanca should be further positioned up on the value map of European financials. The group that you know very well is a sum of four business, very well balanced, with a contribution of revenue that is split between consumer, CIB, and wealth management, with two big contributor of GOP and a good distribution in terms of loan and risk-weighted assets. We operate an integrated business model where we have two high synergic business, wealth management and corporate investment banking. The first, capital light, fee driver and more recurrent. The second, fee driver and more cyclical, to which we add two other business that stands off in terms of diversification opportunity. Consumer banking, heavy capital-intensive business, but big NII driver, anti-cyclical and with great return, as well as a principal investing activity that is EPS and DPS accretive and a revenue driver as well. This four business model was able to grow and deliver substantial results in the last 3 years in terms of revenue, business proposition enhancement, profit and dividend, as well as in maintaining cost income at 46%, gross NPE at lower than 4%, and an important growth in capital generation that was coupled with important increase in dividend distribution. We doubled the dividend distribution compared to the previous 3 years. These kind of results have clearly made that the banks, in terms of stock, has outperformed most of the financial, and this is clear on page seven, where we have had a revenue growth of 7% compared to zero revenue growth of Italian banks and -1% of European banks. And this was evident in every single business line or revenue source, both NII and fees, in terms of PBT, in terms of development of new loans, and in terms also of return on tangible. We achieved 10% compared to an average of 7% and 8% at Italian and European level. We think that these results were due to distinctive DNA, culture, and position. So stability of board has made a lot because our board was able to follow, in the long run, projects, risk, client opportunity. The fact that we enjoy a very strong brand that is associated to high reputation, talent-driven organization, as well as specialization innovation, strong positioning in business that have a long-term growth, are key important element that we also associate to high capital generation, limited exposure to Italian macro and adverse regulation, increased quality in terms of governance and in terms of role that ESG is playing within our daily activity. This is also summarized in what we call accretive value cycle, which we value as a very effective because starting from strong positioning as a specialized finance DNA model, and having a responsible approach to business, we are able to generate important capital flow that are able are used to back the investment position of every business, that in turn let grow the bank in terms of revenue, in terms of also human talent, reverting to above average profitability, and hence become an important recipe for a stakeholder friendly entity. Which are the key trends ahead? We know the key trends ahead are not easy. We can summarize four main key trends in adverse macro, disruptive technology impact, stricter regulation, and rise of the importance of ESG, for which we think that it's important to take selective decision where to be present, becoming even more cost efficient and strong in risk selection, adjust distribution network in a way that can deal with the new demand for customer. Massive use of advanced data and artificial intelligence is more needed, as well as higher capital buffer, asset quality, and low conduct risk. But notwithstanding this kind of key trends, there are also very important possibilities and very interesting business opportunity for Mediobanca. First, Italian wealth management market is very large, still growing, worth 4 trillion, and is still largely unmanaged. Specialized operators are gaining market share. In this field, Mediobanca has set an ambition to become a market leader with high growth rates and sustainability. Corporate and financial sponsors will maintain high the activity, corporate activity in Europe. And in this environment, boutique type organization will continue to take market share. In this field, so in CIB, Mediobanca aims to grow its market presence in Europe in M&A and capital market. Consumer banking in Italy is still underpenetrated. Change consumer behavior requiring new products and distribution. So innovation is becoming important also in consumer banking. Mediobanca consumer banking activity in Compass will leverage its very strong positioning to become back again a real front runner. Then there is another important opportunity for us, that is the fact that unlike universal and commercial bank that are going to be under a very important restructuring exercise due to unprecedented margin squeeze, Mediobanca has no problem of this kind. So has no problem of restructuring of its balance sheet or its cost income, shouldn't close branches, on the contrary, should focus only and will focus only on growth, organic and through M&A. So given this important business opportunity, we think that we should set our ambition in a bold way. So becoming a definitive perceived distinctive growth player in Europe as a financial and value as a specialized financial group. So in this next 4 years, Mediobanca will stand out because of its distinctive business model, by its capability to profit from a challenging macro scenario, and this will be done through a strong positioning and business diversification via culture and stability and sustainability approach to business. We'll grow in terms of capability by brand, revenue, capital and profit, due to sound market opportunities and material investment in people, innovation and distribution. The third part of our ambition is the value creation. We set and revised our target in order to deliver industry-leading stakeholder remuneration, hence self-perpetuating our accretive value cycle, and with important management of talent and capital. How can we get to this kind of results? First, with important investment in talent and innovation. So keeping our efficiency core in the organization, so cost income to stay at 46%, Mediobanca in the next 4 years will invest in human talent and IT digital upgrade in order to improve its offer towards clients' need, and will add roughly 1,000 salespeople at work, out of which two-thirds will be at variable cost, and will also invest 250 million euro in IT, digital upgrade and regulation. This will be coupled with important investment in distribution across the different business. So wealth management will have an empowerment in franchise of 70% increase in sales staff to over 1,400, so up 520, out of which the vast majority will be not hire but financial advisors, so variable cost. This will be the case also in consumer banking, where there will be an important upgrade of distribution from 200 to 350, out of which we will reach 160 agency between Compass new launch Quinto agency and overall Compass agency that will go to 80 from 27. An important enhancement in the footprint in investment banking, thanks to the recent acquisition of Monsieur Maris and what the new professional we will hire in the next 3 years will make that our footprint will be improved by 25%. Investing in distribution, in talent and in technology will make our TFA growing at a very nice level, so 8% CAGR with a level of attachment of 83 billion starting from 61 billion. But which is more important is the mix, because we will have a better mix while deposits will grow only 3% per year, assets under management and assets under administration will grow by 11%. Likewise, growing loan book driven by wealth management will be in the region of 51 billion with a 4% CAGR led by wealth management. And the growing revenue, so the 4% in CAGR of growth in revenue, will made mainly by capital light revenues that will increase to 40% of the total. To this kind of results will contribute every single business. We will go from 2.5 billion euro of revenue to 3 billion euro, where wealth management will contribute with the plus 8%, all capital light, corporate investment banking plus 6%, mainly capital light, consumer banking and principal investment 3% each. This will deliver growth in earning and profitability. ROTE will go up to 11%. And EPS will grow 4%. So EPS will reach 1.1 euro per share, and this improvement in profitability, absolute and on ROTE, will move up Mediobanca in the value map, reaching well above cost of equity return, and especially moving on the right side of the slide 17, where GOP on risk-weighted assets are closer to 3%. All the single business will improve or maintain very high profitability. Wealth management will go from 16 to 25% ROAC. Consumer banking will stay between 28 and 30. Corporate investment banking will go to 16%, and principal investing will stick to 11%. Growth of revenue and ROTE will be associated to important, consistent capital generation. Every year we will generate 135 basis points of CET1. That is the results of 210 basis points produced through earning creation and RWA optimization, that is mainly at operative level and not a regulatory level. that will be invested in by 45 bps in organic growth and 30 bps in book value, generally book value expansion. So this is also taking into consideration that we will not have any negligible impact from the new regulation that from here to the end of the plan will be in place. And leaving room for M&A. So this kind of trajectory of CET1 has been coupled with a new discipline in terms of capital ratio. What we are stating here is that we have understood the optimal level of capital at which we should operate the bank, and we set it at 13.5 phase in, and this is a level that we consider adequate to efficiently run the business, in particular in wealth management in CIB. To keep in mind our zip code, we are an Italian bank, and Italian bank by definition should stay very well capitalized, also compared to other players. So starting from this, we have, and given the rationale of this that can be also seen to the building blocks you see on page 19, so starting from the SREP 825, adding a buffer that is a buffer that maintains our rating and compares well with the peers, and leaving a management buffer, we arrive to the 13.5% that phase in. It's our level of capital that will make also our distribution policy working every year. How? We will increase the dividend starting from 0.47 to 52, so an increase of 10% first year, and then 5% every year. That will make that the dividend per share commitment will increase by 28% in the next 4 years. This means that we will distribute 1.9 billion of dividend in 4 years, and this is coupled with buyback activity. The buyback activity will be made between 0.3 billion and 0.6 billion with the deletion of the share, deleting the share, so not keeping the share for other use, but canceling them every year. So basically what will happen every year is that based on the level of capital we achieved at year end, we will adjust it depending on the M&A we have done, to bring it to 13.5% every year, and hence this will make also every year the make more clear the number of the possible buyback that will be between 0.3 and 0.6 divided by the number of years. So we will have a minimum, but also a possibility to do more depending on the activity and the M&A we have done. M&A that will follow basically what we have done already in the past, so basically going to foster our three core business with preference for capital light businesses with, which have an excellent fit with Mediobanca culture and the possibility of course to generate value throughout the consolidation. Another important news of this plan is the importance of CSR. At all levels, so at board level, in the plan, we picked up 6 sustainable development goals that in which we can be more active, and we have assigned quantitative and qualitative target to each of them, and we have put this kind of achievement, achievement of the target, in a long-term incentive plan to be released to the top management. So the goals are on average training enhancement, on gender diversity, on asset management that has to be throughout screen also with ESG criteria, investment in Italian excellent SME, new project that have an important and positive impact socially or environmentally, work on the procurement as well work on environmental activity, where we want to achieve 92% from renewable resource. We want to lower CO2 emission, and we want also to launch a new product through our RAM company in Carbon Neutral Fund. So which are the benefits for our shareholders if we deliver this plan? They are evident. So there is a big shift to capital light fee business, important revenue growth, and enhance return to shareholder. This is a targeting industry leading performance, because we put together 4% CAGR in revenue, 4% CAGR in EPS, profitability growth at ROT of 11%, and shareholder remuneration that if we put together the dividend that we are committing to and the buyback to the limit of 0.6 billion will reach 2.5 billion. Let's see how we're going to get there through the different business. Wealth management. Starting from wealth management, as you know, is a new story for Mediobanca, or is a recent story for Mediobanca. We entered in this business only 3 years ago, and we wanted to do this strategic move for obvious reasons that are related to our positioning and branding, our customer base in corporate environment, so group synergies, but also the possibility to redeploy capital that we produce. In these 3 years, we have built an affluent segment that is sustainable through the customer eyes and innovative, and we have completed the integration of Banca Esperia into Mediobanca private banking model that is very much attached and operating alongside with the investment banking. Now, as we said, the market is very interesting, and our ambition should be bigger in this segment. Why? We have already said that is made of two segments, 3.5 trillion, the biggest one is in affluent. The vast majority is still unmanaged, and this unmanaged asset may be more natural in years where fixed income, in particular govies, would have yield any significant return. With rates stably negative over the next 4 years, customer needs are different, and the way to serve them will be different. In this environment, what we see is that mixed model and specialized banks are gaining market share against traditional bank, that there is a clear demand for protection, yield, and illiquid, and that it's not yet clear the impact of the new regulation. For the time being, has been soft, the impact of MiFID II consumer production, but I think it's soon to come to conclusion on this. Now, which are the opportunities for our wealth management model, starting from what we have today? In the affluent, it's a large customer base, 800,000 customers, real omnichannel distribution model built to be scalable. We have an important component of NII because it's also the funding arm of the bank. So innovation has been at the very start of CheBanca, as well as the perception to be easy, efficient, and transparent in terms of pricing. In private banking, the edge that we have is that we put together, as we said, IB and PB coverage, and that we are working, or we have been already working for a couple of years now, on having a specialized offer for entrepreneur. So not only for or merely for wealthy client, but in particular for entrepreneur. Now, the action of the last plan has brought this business to a level that is visible, and we are now considered a player in the sector. We have 61 billion, and this compares not badly with the rest of the market. One important element has been also the ability to generate net new money, because we have proved the ability to generate in the region of 5 billion per year. And in the meantime, we have increased materially return on allocated capital from 9 to 16%. This was made also through acquisition and important upscale in Salesforce, because we have tripled the Salesforce of Affluent to 900 people. Now, our ambition in this business is that Mediobanca should become a leading Italian player with high growth rates and sustainability. This has to be true in affluent and private banking. In affluent, we want to become an established player by quality and sustainability, with best in class mix between digital and human distribution capabilities. While in private banking, we want to work even more to a unique offer of private and investment banking model, and also become a market reference for private asset, private market solution. So this business should become the first source of fees, and will become the first source of fees, and the third pillar for net profit in Mediobanca Group. It will become also the second revenue generator of the group. So it will be an important upgrade through a distinctive offer, both to affluent and private clients, also through a raising brand positioning. A second target will be to get more scale and hence invest in distribution and innovation. The third is to improve the return of the capital allocated. Let's see how we're going to do it in affluent and in private. Affluent, as we said, big opportunity, because it's a segment where margins are still there, and there are trends like digital transformation and fintech that CheBanca can clearly leverage, giving take into consideration is digital native nature. There are important actions that we have studied and we are putting in place. The first is a new service model through a different in-depth segmentation of client, serving with the right offer and the right pricing depending on the potential value. This is led by an improvement in product offer, leveraging on group capabilities, investing a lot in a franchise empowerment, so commercial staff to increase by 60%, as we said, and of course this will be coupled with the brand repositioning, with a marketing campaign for affluent clients, and a lot of investment in training to upgrade the Salesforce capability to deliver high quality product. So an upgrade of the positioning of CheBanca that will make that at the end, as you see in the slide 30, we will move up and right in this graph, where in terms of operative leverage, in terms of profitability, so profit before tax, ex performance fee on TFA, we will definitely improve our position. In private investment, in private banking, the opportunity will be, as we said, to work closer to investment banking, and this will come also with the renewed, reinforced and upscaled platform of mid-corporate coverage in CIB, but as well as becoming an important provider of private assets through club deals, private equity, Italian and EU multi-asset managers. So all what is in liquid and alternative is becoming a clear target and it's a differentiation of the offer of Mediobanca Private Banking. And basically the same path will follow Compagnie Monégasque, that will be power up in terms of technology, in terms of product, in terms of relaunch of credit proposition that in Monaco is quite interesting. As we said, between private banking and corporate investment banking, we see growing synergies because the level of joint pitch and the level of mandate generated by private banking to CIB or vice versa is definitely increasing. Key will be the enlargement of the distribution. Salesforce will go up 60% to 1,400. Looking through this number, we see that we will add 155 relationship management and 340 financial advisor and 25 new private banker. This will make that our distribution capacity will be increased by 60%, and this explains a lot in terms of net new money and in terms of the possibility we'll have to make to close the profitability gap. Also, in asset management production, we have a specific goal that we set. Mediobanca SGR will become, will have a pivotal role in defining asset allocation strategy and product innovation, mainly in the liquid part. Cairn Capital will work more and more with the group in terms of also developing a credit fund that will work alongside CIB, while RAM will target ESG, a new kind of product breed. What is key is that at the end of the plan, the in-house product distributed throughout the network of affluent and private will be definitely bigger. This will all this will make that we will improve margin efficiency, so our fee margin will go from 82.82 to 0.90, so 8 bips of uptick. The revenue enhancement will make that we'll have cost income going down by 10 points, so from 79 to 70, and this will boost operating margin from 0.17 to 0.26. Strong growth in total financial assets, we forecast an 8% CAGR to 83 billion, which is more important that the most interesting and juicy part of real managed asset will go from 39 to 59, and 20 billion of increase in 4 years. Loan book as well will grow because we see important opportunity both here and in Monaco as real estate lending and Lombard. So at the end, the division will reach 700 million euro revenues. ROAC will go to 25, but this important development in terms of number are also linked to a quite sustainable and qualitative enhancement. So pricing in line with the best practice in all areas, high recurrent contribution of fees, so in this number no performance fee are included and there is only a 5% upfront in total, no carried interest on private banking initiative, cost income at 70% in all entities, and no fiscal optimization. So basically it's quantity but also qualitative. Going to consumer. Consumer has been a long journey, and this is different from wealth management. We started in the 60s, and it has been always a business in which we wanted to become bigger for a diversification effect vis-à-vis the rest of the group. The rest of the group at the time, and even today, CIB and other businesses are less that are more cyclical than consumer that is more anti-cyclical. Mediobanca has developed a presence is high in, and big and sustainable in terms of profitability. Thanks to outstanding credit scoring, ability to price, and that is linked also to a very strong distribution network and a very important full product range. Now, which are the trends in consumer, at least in Italy or in the market at which we operate? There is an ongoing change in consumer behavior, so a digital shift, good rentals and demographic changes in a market that stay underpenetrated compared to most of the EU countries, where specialized banks, consumer banks, will continue to outperform others because they are specialized by growth and return, and where there could be a credit cycle shift, and also take into consideration the new regulation, this is going to maybe become a problem, in particular for those that are not used to this kind of trend in credit cycle. The Italian banks branches reduction that is ongoing, there will be even more in the future, is creating an opportunity because still most of the credit are sold physically, and hence it opens up territory and opportunity for sale that were not there. On the other hand, the Italian banks aggregation process is likely to become an obstacle to have quite an important part of our credit distributed by bank in the future. Which are our distinctive strengths? It's, you see in this slide on page 40, is the outstanding scoring and pricing capability, the very good asset quality, in the sense that, as you know, Compass is one of the few entities that fully cover in 12 months NPLs and sells it into the market, so deconsolidate from the very beginning NPL, so the possibility to maintain always very clean the balance sheet. Broader integrated distribution network between agency of Compass, branches and third party distributor, as well as broad product capabilities, cost income at 30%, and an approach to new loan that is merely based on value. So, as you know, and what can be also seen from this slide on page 41, we tend to adjust our market share not depending on commercial trend, but depending on the value that we can generate out of new loans. So when the market is less buoyant, we tend to grow in terms of market share. When the market is hot, we tend to decrease because we see less margin. KPI of the last 3 years were fantastic, where with an important increase in branches up 20%, we have reached 1 billion of revenue, GOP of half a billion, and ROAC that went up from 17 to 30%. Compass represents 40% of the revenue in GOP and is the most important engine, as we know, in NII. So we want to confirm and maintain this kind of role. The path of Compass is on page 42, you know quite well, so I won't spend much time on this. We couple an important development of new loan with a very good cost of risk, and hence we managed to have this kind of net contribution. So having said that, as we said, we want to maintain this role for Compass, and we want that Compass, we plan that Compass remain and reinforce its front runner position in consumer banking, taking advantage from macro changes in customer behavior and cycle trends, and also not only with innovation, but also investing in distribution. So basically, in order to assure growth in domestic market, we will invest in distribution. We will embrace innovation in order that new trends can be really scouted and served before others, and we will preserve the profitability. Now, the new plan of Compass is made mainly of proprietary distribution. Why? Because the example of the last 3 years plan in terms of performance of new Compass agency are quite good. And a newly opened Compass agency proved to be with high productivity, close to long-standing Compass branches, low client cannibalization, resilient margin, and core that is totally in line with branches, because as you know, Compass branches are operating under the stewardship and the control of the Compass branch. So a Compass branch, as you know, has a much higher value in terms of new loan compared to any distributed third-party distributed loan. So roughly double what we get through third-party channel. That's why after this first experiment, we wanted to put more emphasis, and we plan to open, to have new 80 branches for Compass Quinto and reach 80 agency for Compass Quinto and new a level of 80 branches of Compass agency in the 2023. This will make that in Cessione del Quinto we will act as a consolidator in a market that needs consolidation and needs also loyal and reputable agent of network that are operating exclusively for Compass, that can exploit also synergy with Compass client. But this kind of enhancement in distribution will be coupled also with important project innovation. We have spotted four main projects on which we are working. One is a closed loop card for a retailer. So as you know, retailers are incentivizing sales through specific credit card. We are working for large retailers with a new type of credit card that can become quite an interesting application. We have launched Compass Rent for innovative long-term car rental. We are upgrading our existing online platform in order to get in short term to instant lending activity, so timing to yes will be reduced to 1 hour, and there will be the possibility to upload all the ID documents. As well, we have interesting project with two other partners in instant credit and e-commerce loan. This is clearly a new frontier, and we want Compass to be there when this is becoming more material. Now, seeing at the number of Compass new loan business, we will reach 8 billion, and this 8 billion will be made of basically an important increase in salary in point of sale, in salary guaranteed, and a shift in personal loan that will be, as we said, more produced by Compass direct branches and agency and less by third-party distribution agreement. This will make that the enlarged network will support further loan book growth. So we will have at the end of the period 14.1 billion of loans, and this will continue to foster the growth of NII of the group. So we see that revenue will go up 3%, and even including a physiological rebound, but contain of cost of risk, we will able to stay in the region between 28 and 30% of return on allocated capital. Corporate investment banking has been the native business of Mediobanca, so the DNA of the parent company and basically most of the DNA of Mediobanca is attached to this. Mediobanca has a CIB that is distinctive, no, in terms of strong brand recognition, client-driven business, boutique type of approach, coupled with steady profitability, with low gearing and excellent asset quality. In this period, as we know, in the last 10 years at least, banks in investment banking have had hard times, in particular in Europe. So the revenue pool has been shrinking since 2010, 5% per CAGR. In this segment, winner have been also boutique advisory firm that have taken market share. So the reaction of IB industry has been to focus on cost cutting, with largest banks deeply restructuring and exiting business. Also take into consideration that regulation has been more severe and will be more severe, because part of the regulation will come in place in the next, two or three years. On the other hand, we think there are important opportunities because we think that corporate, large corporate and financial sponsor activity will stay high in Europe because of sector consolidation disruption, low organic growth, low cost of debt, and ample dry power of financial sponsor. We think that in mid-cap there are interesting opportunities because it's not yet targeted as by all the bulge brackets, and it requires a more, strong distribution locally. And we think there are opportunities also in capital market because we think that progressively the lending needs of corporates will be partly at least replaced by capital market activity. Now, in this environment, Mediobanca stands out like a boutique-like organization, 80% revenue customer-driven, lean and flexible structure, so 46% cost income, as we said, attractive to talent, with a strong balance sheet in terms of asset quality and risk assessment, and some strong footprint because in pan-European presence in Italy, France, Spain, Portugal, and in capital market in UK, and recognized capability in sector like FIG, TMT, automotive, and in cross-border deal. With an increasing spree of working, at least in Italy, with private banking, and I would say a good diversified revenue base that is divided between lending, advisory, capital market, and specialty finance. Now, the job of the last 3 years has been to, in a tough scenario, to maintain and improve our results and profitability. So we maintain flat our revenue, but with an improved mix because advisory and capital market are now at 50%, specialty finance at 20%, and we, thanks also to improvement in capital allocation, we brought the ROAC at 15%, it was 10, and this compared to less than 10% of sector average. In these 3 years, we have done quite an important string of transactions in large M&A, as you see on page 53, in selected mid-corporate transaction and also in ECM. Now, our plan is to continue alongside what we have done in the last few years to make out of Mediobanca a more important leading investment bank in Europe, but with a specific focus in M&A and capital market to support large and mid-caps client in their domestic or cross-border transaction. How to do this? Empower distribution, exploit market opportunity in terms of synergies, and manage even better the capital allocation to maintain and even improve our ROAC. In the meantime, we will act as a possible consolidator of boutique on the back of what we have done already with Monsieur Maris in advisory and in capital market. Now, there are three main projects that are driving the increase in revenue and profitability. One is empowering the origination platform. On top of Monsieur Maris, we will hire roughly 15 bankers that are covering senior bankers that are covering clients. We will boost our coverage on sovereign wealth fund and infra sponsor, as well as on mid cap, on which we have a separate slide. Markets activity will be increased also because we have created a new division and we have assigned new responsibility in markets, combining fixed income, equity derivative, and cash equity. So we think that there will be important opportunity in terms of DCM, ECM cross-selling, and also to leverage better our existing presence in UK as a hub and increase investor reach in Europe. In fixed income, we think that insurance and private wealth management sector will create an opportunity, as well as other territory in which we are less present in terms of coverage. While in equity derivatives and in cash equity, the focus will be on sovereign wealth fund, cross-sell with cash equity to achieve an integrated equity offering in major European markets. While in cash equity, we think that we have very well survived the MiFID introduction, and hence we think that selectively we can increase our market share. Now, a second important initiative is in mid-corporate in Italy. Mediobanca aims to become a leading investment bank for mid-corporates in Italy. This is a key area for different reasons: possibility to increase our advisory revenue pool in Italy, second, possibility to increase our, I would say, customer base in private banking. For this reason, we have established a new mid-cap and financial sponsor integrated platform to coordinate efforts between mid-corporate and financial sponsor team, and to ensure coverage of Italian mid-size segment with the full CIB product offering. This will lead ultimately also to gain market share in financial sponsor sell side. So here the main initiative will be increase origination execution capabilities, cross-sell with private banking, cross-sell with other IB products, and also forge some operative partnership with partners that are not in our territory to capture a deal flow that today is not on the radar screen. To make the number better, we will also work on capital, more efficient use of capital. So we have three initiatives, two in credit and one in market. We will work more with an approach of origin and distribute. In particular, we will generate with our MAM activity a number of new initiatives in illiquid credit that we work together with our lending department in order to capture market opportunity for us and also for clients that wants to be exposed to this asset class. We will do a couple of securitization of a selected loan portfolio in order to improve the return on allocated capital of the division, as well as we will improve the standard model of market in order to save some capital that today is in this segment. Now, which are the results of this kind of initiative? Are selective loan growth in the region of 2%. Important growth in revenue that is taking into consideration the fact that basically we are now consolidating also Messier Maris. So part is a new perimeter effect, part is a rebound of the activity, and also taking into consideration a normalized capital market environment. Increased in profitability of 1 point that in reality is an important improvement, because as you know, the last few years of CIB has been affected positively by write-backs. We think that we can have further write-backs in the next couple of years, but we have prudently forecast that in year four we won't have any write-backs, so we will have a modest cost of risk, but a real cost of risk, and no write-backs in 2023. So for this reason, 16% of ROAC is, I think, an interesting target. Principal investing rationale behind Generali is that is EPS accretive, is a revenue stabilizer, and generates a return above cost of capital. On top of this, there is a very important, or two other important rationale or reason. One is that is a very important option value in terms of releasing capital. Raising capital for any reason. First of all, because we are an Italian bank, as we said, so we need to stay always very well capitalized. Second, because it's easy accessible capital for us in case we want to do a transaction that is more sizable than the one we have described when we talk about M&A strategy, those kind of M&A is more an M&A of 20-25 bips of capital consumption per year. In this case, we could target definitely bigger transaction. So it will stay. It will stay. If we see what we have done in the past, is we have retained the stake for different reasons, because has been and will be a profitable investment. We have created more capital, and regulation was favorable for us, because at the end the Danish compromise, as you said, as you know, has been extended until 2024. So it will stay as an important revenue EPS stabilizer. It will have, even in the 3 years plan, on a fully loaded metric, 11% return, and it will be capital accretive with significant revenue contribution. Holding function will confirm their role of becoming or improving even their treasury ALM activity, common business services, and also managing the non-core business, in particular leasing. On this optimized treasury ALM center, we will face an ordinary level of maturity, which we will, I would say, face with inflow of wealth management deposit, 3 billion, more secure funding, and some selective senior bond issuance. TLTRO 3 will be replaced, replacing TLTRO 2. So instead of 4.4, we will have 4. And substitution strategy will be after 2023 with ABS and wealth management deposits. So we will end with 2.5 billion at the end of the plan. We start with 4 billion of TLTRO. MREL liability is stable at abundant levels, so abundant levels, so 35% of RWA. Here, what we and MREL target currently at 21.4, so basically no big changes. We may envisage some swap between the Tier 2 and the senior non-preferred with the same amount, so we will have maturity of 1.5 billion of Tier 2, and we will most likely substitute them with 1.5 senior non-preferred. LCR will be optimized, while NFR will stay in the region 110. Now, we think that the delivery of the plan will definitely reinforce the accretive value cycle. Why? Because our strong positioning will be even stronger after the 4 years plan. Because in these 4 years we will be able to turn challenging macro sectorial trend into opportunities and gain market share from competitors. We will have a board that whose CSR, in which CSR will become more important, and will set quantitative targets defined in LTI senior management plan. The generation of capital will be super solid, because we will generate 540 bips of capital in 4 years to foster organic growth, M&A, and shareholder remuneration. This will lead to unbroken growth path, so 4% in revenue and earnings, that will revert into an increased return on tangible equity, but which is even more important, and definitely increased banking ROAC to 17%. This will lead to up to 2.5 billion distribution to shareholder, a bank that grow and hire people and is not closing branches, is not firing people, and that continue to lend to its community. Now, this is consistency. It's nothing but consistency, because we have been doing this in the last 3 years, so we will do the same with the renewed effort in the next 4 years. This will lead to, I think, a different evaluation of the group, because basically we'll make that Mediobanca should be positioned further up, as we said, in the value map of European financial, alongside peers that have similar growth and risks. So from traditional bank that has been or may have been the current peer set to a targeted peer set where whose revenue growth and risk are more similar to the Mediobanca one. Thank you very much. I think I have been annoyed you for a long time, so now I stop. I give you the floor for questions.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. If you wish to ask a question, please press the star and one on your telephone keypad and wait for your name to be announced. Once again, that is star and one if you wish to ask a question. The first question comes from the line of Antonio Reale from Morgan Stanley. Your line is open.
Hi, good afternoon, and thank you very much for the presentation. I have three questions, please. The first one is on corporate investment banking. I mean, you're clearly different from traditional investment banks, and that's been a key competitive advantage throughout the years. We've seen a number of banks change the allocation of capital across different products, and that's clearly had an impact on the competitive landscape. Now, going forward, how do you see the allocation of capital, particularly in terms of RWA density for you, play out? And how do you see Mediobanca fit versus the competitive landscape, both US and European peers, going forward? Second question is on your share buyback commitment of 0.3 and up to 0.6 billion throughout the plan. Has this been approved by the ECB? And the last question is on M&A. I understand you've kept the capital budget for M&A in the plan similar to last time, 100 basis points of CET1. Now, how are you thinking between a transformational M&A deal versus smaller size acquisitions, considering also that Generali is now at above 19 euros per share? And where do you see most opportunities given current valuation levels, particularly looking at the Italian asset managers? Thank you.
Thank you, Antonio. CIB, we think that with the capital management initiative that we have detailed, with these three initiatives, we will be able to bring down the RWA intensity from 58 to 47. Share buyback is not approved by ECB, but it's like in every situation of this kind, we have discussed with ECB the plan in advance and the buyback plans in advance. So formal authorization has to be given at the right moment. For the right moment, as we know, this right moment will be October 2020. But given our capital ratio, we don't see any problem. M&A, I think we should be ready to everything in the sense that our normal cruise is to grow organically, as we have a very important growth opportunity, hiring people and also taking market share. But we should always look at M&A that can speed up our growth, where we should grow more. For sure, should we have a wealth management that have the same contribution of the rest in terms of bottom line? We are doubling with the plan, but we are not at the level, target level, no, because it's a business which we are only since 4 years. So distribution in wealth management is a key area, and also we can look at some product company that are in the alternative in liquid. I would say that for the first, we may be able to do small deal and large deal. It will be very difficult that we do a large acquisition in an asset management company, even in alternative or in a CIB operator. So I would rather look at mid-sized deal like Monsieur Maris or Capital Market Platform that are within the region of 300, 400 million euro, as well as in the alternative world, while in wealth management we may be also open to do larger deal redeploying the Generali stake.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question comes from the line of Christian Caresse from Intermonte. Your line is open.
Hi, good afternoon. The first question is on margins. Slide 45, you show that you are expecting some increase in margin in wealth management division from 82 to 90 basis points, if you can elaborate a little bit. On revenues, corporate investment banking, 6% KGR, we saw flattish revenues at the end of the day in the previous plan. If you can also give us the idea of the MMA contribution to the 6% growth in the plan horizon. Then for the question on cost of risk, you show you are expecting just a slight higher cost of risk within the plan with a GDP growth at 0.5% on average for the next 4 years. I was wondering if you can give us a sensitivity to GDP slowdown in terms of higher cost of risk. And finally, on actually two questions. The fourth one is on contingency action in case GDP will be lower than your assumption. And finally, on strategy, looking at the valuation of Mediobanca, almost one time the tangible equity and the excess capital you have, why don't you plan a more aggressive acquisition in the wealth management business? If I look, for example, to some listed companies, they have a 20% plus return on allocated capital. So if I look at the Generali contribution with a return in the area of 15%, maybe it could be a good deal to speed up this kind of process. So if you can share with us your thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you, Christian. On margins, basically, how are we going to increase margin? It's a mix of, as we said, client segmentation, better client segmentation, and appropriate product offer for each segment of clients. As you know, CheBanca has a number of clients that are also the outcome of history. So he started as an ING type of bank, so they have both retained client, affluent and premier. Now, we have to serve each of them with a different product offer, with a different pricing. So it comes out of segmentation, different product offer and different mix of product, because back again, in the product mix, you can put more interesting product for the clients and for you, more third-party products or more in-house product. We will work on every layer, and this is the outcome of the uptick in profitability. 6% CAGR of CIB, you said quite demanding because you have been flattish. Yes, but take into consideration the region of 40 million will come from the consolidation of Messier Maris. And of course, we think that this improvement, as we already seen in terms of coverage, is not only limited to France. France is a very important country in Europe in terms of corporates doing a lot of deals in the rest of the world and in Europe. So if you reinforce France, you definitely reinforce all the rest of the group. And you have access to clients not only for advisory but also for the other CIB product. Of course, as we said, Christian, we think that in 3 years capital market will normalize and we will have a better chance to do IPO and capital increase. If not, of course, our revenue will be lower. Cost of risk, we haven't put it, but it's no mystery to say that we have plan to have in the region of 75 basis points of cost of risk, and this is based on two basic assumptions. The first, in CIB, the fact that we will not have the year 3 and year 4 any write-backs, and the second, that it's normal that starting from the bottom line, from the bottom of cost of risk, all-time bottom of Compass, it's natural that we will have, or we forecast at least, to have an increase in cost of risk that is contained. contingency action on GDP contraction. At the end, as we said, we are not that much exposed to GDP. On the contrary, if GDP contracts and other are scared, we can grow more. In the sense that, as we have seen in Compass, we tend to grow market share when others are less active on the market. On the contrary, we tend to lower market share when it's super hot and at the end you don't preserve too well the margin. So we are not too much exposed. For sure, if GDP contracts, we will have maybe less AUM, net new money, because maybe this is going to be something that prevents household or private clients to put money at work, but the rest is more an opportunity for us. The last point is right what you say. Well, it's right and needs to be commented. First, there are no clear available target. So the panel of wealth managers that you mentioned that are all listed, they are all doing well. They either wants to stay independent or they are belonging to groups or to family. So, and we are ready to discuss if there is an opportunity or someone wants to discuss with us, but to our knowledge, there is no today availability for a transaction. The second is the value, no? Rightly, you pointed out the multiple at which they trade. We came at the end of a year where, as you know, MiFID II has not really been harsh to anybody. Performance fees are very high. So basically, the valuation of all the wealth managers that are listed today discount a very rich year. So is it granted that 2020-2021 will be the same? Nobody knows, but I won't be sure. So the fact that today nothing is available is not such a bad news, because basically the situation may normalize and availability may become more in 6 months or 9 months, where also the visibility of stickiness of revenues may be different.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The next question comes from the line of Anna Benassi. Please ask your question.
Yeah, good afternoon. Actually, because you answered on the mystery of the cost of risk, which is 75 basis points, as I was expecting, that means there probably is cost that makes the difference. So, in fact, you are adding over 1,000 plus professionals, which is a big number. So my question is, how are you prepared to attract so many talents, and what is the cost of that? So how long will it take to go break-even for them? So the question is, after 2023, assuming the hiring and attraction of people happens in an heavenly way, how much additional revenues we could have in mind at full speed? The other question is about the Indonesian tentative acquisition. What have you put in your plan targets from there? The other point is your assumption of a 2% increase in Generali net profit contribution, claiming you are looking at the consensus. Actually, I have a very good insurance analyst colleague, and I'm using his numbers, and he's talking about more than 6%. So it looks like this 2% assumption is a bit conservative to me. And finally, I hear you talking about no immediate available sizable targets in wealth management, but in theory, would you be prepared to put a capital increase on top of selling Generali shares to go for a transformational deal in wealth management? Thank you.
Grazie, Anna. In basically, we are sticking to 46% of cost income at the end of the plan. The people we are adding are only partly hired, so out of 1,000, 400 are hired, 600 are agents, so are more variable cost. And I tell you that we are having a very good inflow of new financial advisor and relationship management. So the hiring spree is having already now the speed and the pace it should have to get to the plan. So of course this has an impact in overall cost, because we grow revenue, we grow cost, and we stay at the same cost income. But as we see a lot of opportunity to become bigger in wealth management, we of course want to profit on this. Indonesia deal is not factored in this plan, so there is nothing. So if and when we close the deal, it will be an add-on, and for the time being is not forecasted, and so is not in the number. Yes, you're right. We have had 2 or 3%, if I remember well, increase CAGR of revenue for Generali. This is the consensus. We took the consensus. Maybe you have, we should have done a smart consensus, as we call it, but it's a consensus, so we took it as it is. Fourth question. I think it depends on the quality of the assets. For a good asset, I think the priority would be basically not to ask money to our shareholder and to use the available capital. Of course, if we use the available capital and we optimize all the metrics like earning per share impact through disposal of Generali shares, totally or partly, and issuance of other Mediobanca share to do a deal, we are available to do this. The reality is that for the time being, there are no discussion of this kind.
Amazing. Be brave.
Grazie, Anna. Ciao.
Ciao.
Thank you. The next questions come from the line of Giovanni Razzoli from Equita. Your line is open.
Good afternoon to everybody. A couple of questions on my side. The first one to summarize on the intense Q&A session on M&A. If I look at your dividend distribution and buyback assumptions, is it fair to assume that you may devote from 300 to 600 million euros of capital to acquisition, leveraging on the excess capital and using the flexibility of the buyback? So this is for mid-size acquisition. What you've mentioned would look mainly on asset management companies, specialized asset management company with a focus on liquid assets. That's my first question. And instead, if I were to square, what could be your firepower? I should include 250 million euros of treasury shares and 2 billion euros contribution on Generali. So in theory, leveraging on your existing resources, you may get to up to 3 billion euros for a kind of transformational deal. So are these numbers correct? Second question related to the dividend policy. You have an history of very generous dividend payout ratio, very generous dividend policy. I was wondering whether in the context of still low visibility for the dividend policy of the banks, you're in a peculiar situation, but regulation is still there. May you consider the payment of a quarterly or an interim dividend? That's my second question. The third question, can you share with us what are your assumptions in terms of the growth of the revenues in advisory and ECM over the next couple of years? And the last question, you've shown us that you have a pretty much significant AUM growth leveraging on acquisition of, if I'm not mistaken, 340 financial advisors. Maybe you have already answered to this question, but what is the contribution in terms of new net new money that you expect from those new colleagues in the plan? Thank you.
Thank you, Giovanni. So you are right. Your numbers are correct in the sense that for ordinary M&A, we prefer to talk about capital consumption rather than total amount of money, because basically it depends on the goodwill. But within the number that are in the capital remuneration, embedded is an M&A that every year has 20-25 basis points of attrition of capital. And you are also right in what we can do theoretically using all our firepower. So basically what we can do, we can even do more than what you say, because we can use the stake in Generali, and of course we can use our stock, because our stock is trading at good multiple. So basically, but a transaction in the region of above 2 billion, 2, 3, and even more billion is doable, theoretically. You know, it's like I would say more an analysis, desktop analysis, than, as I said, a real action plan. Dividend policy. You give me the opportunity to comment a bit more on the dividend policy. What we wanted to do, we wanted to give visibility of an increasing dividend policy in an environment where increasing dividend policy will be not a very well, I would say, taken policy by everybody, because banks will have more hard times to increase dividend in the future. So as we can do in terms of capital and earning generation, we wanted to do. Now, going to quarterly policy dividend is a big jump for us, because we need to understand the feasibility. We don't rule it out, but it's too soon today to put it under discussion. While we don't give detail about the different source of revenues, because of course we have guided on top line, we didn't guided on source of revenues. I can tell you that out of the 20 billion of managed asset in 4 years, 10 are coming from private banking and alternative asset management, 10 is coming from affluent, half of which is from financial advisor, and 5 billion are coming from relationship management. Now, take into consideration that the target of a new financial advisor has to be in the region of 15 million of portfolio. So then you multiply by 340 and you should get there also with what you have of existing workforce.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next questions come from the line of Alberto Cordara from Bank of America. Your line is open.
Good afternoon. The first question relates to a point previously raised regarding the Indonesian business. As I understand it, you have not included in your forecast. Out of memory, I think that this business was supposed to contribute 20 million to the associate revenue line. So I just wanted to see if you can confirm roughly these guidelines, and then if you can let us know more or less should we expect a possible closing. The second point relates to all your comments about boosting up the financial advisory network, which I find incredibly interesting. It seems to me that through the plan you are investing in this network, but you may not reach the steady state. What do I mean by that is you're putting the premise probably for an even stronger earnings growth in the next plan once you would be reaching the critical mass that you want to achieve. Just wanted to have a comment on this. I know that is very premature, but just wanted to have your opinion on this point. And then as a last point, we saw recently a change in your shareholder structure, with UniCredit being a very traditional shareholder of Mediobanca exiting its investment. Just wanted to hear from you if you have any comment about this specific situation. Thank you.
Grazie Alberto. Today, prudently, we have not included in the revenue the Indonesian business. Basically, is what I've told you, is in the region of $20 million dollars, or basically depends on the year, can be if they make better results. This quarter has been a very good one for them. Yearly consolidation may become between 18 and 20 million of top line that goes down to bottom line, because of course it's like consolidating generally earnings. Today we have had, as I said, not today, even the last call, we have had some positive news, but still, it takes time in terms of authorization and closing, so we hope to update you with positive news, but today we are not in a position to give this positive news because more has to come. I didn't understand well the second question, but basically, you are right in the sense that I strongly believe that financial advisor, in particular their entrepreneurship, their ability to adapt, and the fact that they are specialized sales force, it's something that we like a lot. Why? If you see, it's a bit the same in the other two businesses. Investment banking people are only doing this. Compass people are only doing this. So we like a lot specialized sales network that they do 24 hours a day, or basically 12 hours a day, only one specific task, and they do it very well. Now, we were lucky to recruit very good people to add this kind of new initiative that is over time becoming more evident in Italy, so we are recruiting from everybody now. This is positive and negative. Positive because you grow, negative because you receive a lot of letters when you take on good people from everybody. So you are right, our appetite is growing there. We know that wealth management requires time, create every day value, because it's a building block of the value that we are creating, but requires time. We cannot run more than that. But we are getting more convinced, if this is the question. Yes, I consider the disposal of UniCredit or stake in Mediobanca a net positive for everybody, net positive for us, because we have a more normalized investor base, and UniCredit was never seen as a credible shareholder of Mediobanca, given the fact that it operates in the same territory, in the same business of Mediobanca. So it's positive for us, it's positive for UniCredit, it's positive for the system, because I think that Italian banks may have better chance if they have normal, standard, institutional, important shareholder base that is reflected in appropriate governance at board level.
Many thanks. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question comes from the line of Azzurra Guelfi from Citibank. Your line is open.
Hi, good afternoon. A couple of questions. The capital allocation, it seems to be a switch out of investment by CIB into consumer credit and to wealth management. Can you give us some trend in terms of risk-weighted asset? Because I think that based on the plan data, there shouldn't be much risk-weighted asset growth. The other one is on fees. Within the revenue, is it fair to assume that most of the growth is coming from fees? And I know we have asked you already a lot about the M&A, but it seems that the debate has been mostly focused on domestic opportunity. Would you consider a deal even transformational abroad? Thank you.
In terms of capital, yes, Azzurra, it's right what you say, in the sense that we basically will keep flat or with the improvement in operational efficiency the consumer, we will decrease the capital, the intensity at least, no? This is intensity. Then, of course, we will expand lightly the balance sheet, because as you've seen, we will have a minor growth in we will have a billion or 2 billion growth, if I remember well, in CIB, that will be counterbalanced by the efficiency and securitization. And a bit more capital will go to wealth management, because basically in wealth management we will have more credit, because between Italy and Monaco the credit book that is secured will go up. So you are right, it's if you see from this perspective, this is quite interesting. There is a capital reallocation internally. We don't guide on source of revenue, but it's fair to say that what we are doing makes that we will have fee growth that will be more important than NII growth. M&A, we have to be very much convinced of a large transaction outside Italy. Why? Because in Italy we have a lot of opportunity of growth, and so we should have quite an interesting target, resilient, we understand, we can manage, that is mainly fee-based and non-volatile, to go for that. So is this possible? Theoretically, yes. Practically, I think less.
I just wonder about that, because you have expanded your CIB abroad, and maybe you can put it aside of
for sure there
your
are,
Italian growth.
No, that is like asking me something that I like, in the sense there are some boutiques that I like a lot in Europe and in the world, but I think if they become too big, the possibility for us to do a reasonable deal and for them to stay with us, it's less evident. So I think it's and also the value to be put at stake will be, the goodwill will be bigger. So basically why we will be always in the market to see whether other type of deal like Messier Maris in other part of Europe, in England, in Germany, in Spain, maybe also in other country, reasonable, as well as capital market boutique. I think a large one will have an execution risk that is very big. So we should be very convinced to do this. Today, I doubt. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question come from the line of Domenico Santoro from HSBC. Your line is open.
Hello, hi, good afternoon. Thanks for the presentation and your time responding to our questions. Just have a couple of follow-up questions. First of all, on the cost side, I mean, you have quite demanding target in the wealth management, and if I back solve for the cost income ratio, the cost base is going to be 1.4 billion more or less. How shall we think about this in case of revenues they don't progress the way you think, because you are investing a lot in terms of branches, so you're recruiting people in the CIB, is a sort of a unflexible level, or you might maintain these 46%, whatever is the level of revenues. The second question is on the capital again. I mean, you will end up with a capital which is much higher, of course, than the 13.5% phase-in that you mentioned as a target, even considering 100 basis points devoted to M&A. First of all, are you including any top-up, any M&A in the revenues as well, progression, or is it just organic? And then, with a better capital, is this 2% of total capital as a sort of a binding conclusion in terms of buyback, or at the end, if you end up with more, you might think about, you know, revising this 600 million euro limit. And then a question on NII. I know that you don't give visibility on the revenues target, but I'm just looking at your slide on the holding function where you have some funding optimization, and you also mention a reduction of the LCR, maybe by a different amount of bond. So given that your loan growth is 4 and presumably your NII growth is much lower than this, how shall we think about margin in all the division? That would be helpful. Thank you.
Sorry, I was not opening the line. I give you two numbers on question number one. 70% target of cost income in wealth management, 46 at group level. Now, you rightly say, well, Alberto, but if you don't have the revenue, you end up having a bigger cost income. Look, we have some room to maneuver this. But I tell you, we'll not sacrifice the growth and expansion in wealth management if should we have 46 or even 48% of cost income. Because basically for us, it's more important the strategic priority to grab market share and to become bigger there. Second question on buybacks. Yes, you are right in the sense that what we do will do is every end of the year. So for us, July or end of June, we make our calculation about what we have in terms of capital above 13.5 and what we have done or it's likely that we do in short term, and then we decide the buyback. The buyback can even be bigger than the 2%, as you said, because it will basically derived from the capital ratio at the moment. There is a limit of 13%. So if we go below 13% of phase-in, of course, we should rethink about what we can how we can remunerate. NII basically, revenue are going to grow 4%. Within this growth, we have better growth for fee and still a growth for NII. This NII, you're right, we have room optimization in LCR, we do it, but you have to know that, as you know, that we will not charge negative interest rates to clients, so expanding the wealth management deposits will come anyhow at a cost because we cannot charge negative interest rates to clients. So there is there are some optimization option there, but there is also some limit that as we have forecasted 50 basis points of negative Euribor for 4 years in a row. So basically the growth of NII is more function of bigger volume, no? Has been always the case. Compass growing loan book will be the main driver of NII growth even for the next 3 years. Then on top will be wealth management NII.
Sorry, do you mind giving us, sorry about that, do you mind giving us the level of risk-weighted assets at the end of the plan, please?
It will stay basically at the same level as of today, because we will have some development and some optimization. At the end, it will be basically broad in line.
Good. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question comes from the line of Manuela Neroni from Banca IMI. Your line is open.
Good afternoon. I have three questions. The first one is on the revenue growth. I'm wondering what is the trajectory in revenue growth that you have assumed in your business plan? Should we expect a linear growth or a growth that is front-loaded or back-loaded? The second question is on risk-weighted assets optimization. You mentioned some risk-weighted asset optimization at operating level. Did you refer to the originate to distribute model, or there is something else here? If you can elaborate a little bit more, and also if you can quantify the benefit that you can expect from that. And the third question is on the CIB. You have a well-diversified revenue base between lending advisory, capital markets, and specialty finance. Do you expect different growth rates for the different business activities in your business plan? Thank you.
Revenue growth, of course, will be linked to the expansion of the network. So the average is 4%. But I think that it's fair to say that the more we grow the network, the more we grow the revenue. So somehow it will be a bit more stronger in the second part of the plan than in the first part. RWA optimization, you rightly pointed out about some initiative. We have a slide in CIB that makes that we will target three kind of improvement in credit. Originate to distribute, because what we want to do is what has been already done by other operators that have created alongside the CIB credit fund that are work in acquisition finance LBO activity, and also and work more on fee and less on take and hold kind of approach. The second is 4 billion of synthetic securitization of the portfolio Mediobanca, CIB. The third is the improvement of the standard model of market risk, where we can obtain some savings. The rest is broadly in line, because basically consumer at the end of the plan would be the same, and the wealth management has been already validated, so we'll have some inflation of RWA because there will be more credit, but full stop. The third question was on CIB, growth rate, yeah. Well, it's fair to say that we think advisory is gonna be more important, and also some markets activity will stay, in particular solution activity will stay on the high level. But I think the plan is forecasting an increase in advisory only also because of the consolidation of Messier Maris, and on top of, I would say, a reasonable development. And as we said, the normalization of capital markets. So to give you an example, we think that in 3 years we should be in a position to have same number of a couple of years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, when equity market in terms of equity raising, equity placement was more normal.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question comes from the line of Hugo Cruz from KBW. Your line is open.
Hi, sorry, thanks for the time, but I don't have further questions.
Thank you very much. So, if there are no any further questions, I thank you very much for the patience. It has been a long call with a long session of Q&A. We deserve it because it was an important moment, that is the 3.5 years plan. So thank you very much. I hope you have you all for the Q2 results that will be in February. Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you. That does conclude our conference for today. Thank you all for participating. You may now disconnect.